If you brought a copy of Scripture, you can find the last chapter of Matthew, Matthew chapter 28, in the last verses, otherwise known as the Great Commission, as we continue in our series in context, studying famous or favorite, whichever you prefer, passages in Scripture within their context, and really not just textual context, but historical, especially pertaining to this message today on believers' baptism. You're looking at the text right now, so let's go ahead and let's read it together. So since you're looking at it, read it on the screen. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age." So the year is 1523. You remember it well, don't you? 6 years after the Reformation has gone into full swing. In 1517, that's when Martin Luther nailed his 95 arguments against the sale of indulgences in the Catholic Church, and that began, that really was springboard of the Reformation into play. 6 years later, two other luminaries from the Reformation, not names as well known as Martin Luther, are standing together. They're good friends, and they're standing in front of a moat, looking into the water. One is Huldrych Zwingli. Some of you have heard that name tossed around a little bit. The other is Balthazar Hubmaier, not a name you're probably familiar with. But they were friends. They were theologians. They were men of the Bible. And now that the Bible had been handed back to God's people, salvation through by grace, through faith alone, is being preached. These two men who believe these Reformation doctrine graces are having a discussion about infant baptism in front of a moat. Both of them conclude that it's not biblical. They both are talking about this regulative principle that the reformers gave us in that time. That is, if it's not in the Bible, you have to reject it. And they both agreed to that. Balthazar Hubmaier followed his personal conviction and courageously began to teach and was the first to preach what we've come to know today as believers' baptism. Huldrych Zwingli, who agreed with him on that day in 1523, did an about-face. He not only rejected believers' baptism, but ferociously went against it and began, and actually was one of the principal players of developing a theology of infant baptism. So you might be saying, what's the big deal? Why is this such a big deal? It's almost impossible without a thorough study of history for you to realize how crucial this moment was. Because infant baptism had been around for centuries. And it had political connections, political ties. If you were, you could be a Lutheran country or a Catholic country or a Protestant country. And all of this was tied into baptism. Listen to by the way, Zwingli would go on to become one of the great persecutors of anybody who would be rebaptized or be the rebaptizer. Here's how one writer put it. It's hard to remember how radical this view, believers' baptism, was considered back in the 16th century. If you became a Baptist, you were considered not just doctrinally wrong or unpopular, but in positive danger to the foundations of civic order in Christendom. Indeed, an enemy of the state. The Roman Catholic Church and Protestant churches agreed that you should repent or die. The best you could hope for was exile from the established civilization. These rebaptizers were called the radicals. Now, just 5 years later, 1528, and Balthazar Hubmaier, in the very same city where he was with his friend Huldrych Zwingli looking into that moat, Zurich, Switzerland, was stretched out on the rack and then burned at the stake. Are you ready for this? All at the approval of Huldrych Zwingli. That sounds insane because Zwingli believed in the Reformation doctrines. But again, the church and the state were so melded together in those days, the radicals, the Anabaptists, as they were later come to be known as, didn't just give us the believer's baptism doctrine. They gave us the understanding of the separation of powers. They understood that the church and the state are different institutions. They're not the same. They gave us the free church movement. And all the ramifications of that is what all of these other movements were reacting to. Perhaps no other aspect, doctrine of Christendom and Christianity has been more confusing down through the centuries than baptism. Biblically, it seems, you know, pretty straightforward. If you read the Bible, they got saved, they got baptized, they walked with Jesus, right? That's not hard to see. The Ethiopian eunuch, having heard the gospel, see, here's water. What's keeping me from being baptized? Philip says, you got to believe. And he does. He gets baptized. And then they settle into a life of obedience to God. Not without issues, problems, and struggles, of course. But the saved, listen to this, the saved, then baptized person was the one considered as the full-on follower of Jesus Christ. And it was never otherwise. The saved, then baptized individual was considered the full-on follower of Jesus. My good friend Dave Heisterkamp, our first church planter, used to work for a really prestigious car dealership. He was a manager of it years ago before he dedicated his life to the Lord. And he was, and he would tell us that they would have thousands of people come in, test cars, drive cars, but then hundreds would buy them. And so he would tell his salesman, we don't count them until we see taillights. I like that. We don't count them until we hear splashes. Not because, not to confuse the idea, and that's what we're out to do today, to make it clear. Baptism doesn't save, but it's the outward expression that I am saved. It's the public declaration of our faith that I am identifying with Jesus in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. As time would go on, after the church began, confusion entered in. And then why people got baptized, when people got baptized, how people got baptized began to change dramatically. And I'm just going to say to you that I personally believe it has been one of, if not the greatest accomplishments of Satan himself, to confuse churches on the subject of baptism. And so to this day, we have hundreds of churches that attach grace, salvation, and forgiveness and the initiation into the Christian community by way of baptism. And this is confusing and it's wrong. By the way, just out of curiosity, how many of you were raised in a church that baptized babies, whether it was for salvation or dedication or otherwise? Lots of you, myself included. And where did this teaching come from? Where did this infant baptism come from? I don't want to spend a great deal of time, but I get asked so often, where does it come from? I've thought about it myself. Let me just give you a quick overview. We do see instances in history of infant baptism as early as the second century. Not teaching per se, but individuals who were baptized as infants. During the 200s, we see it having become sort of an initiation rite. And thus it sort of paved the way toward infant baptism. And during that time was this understanding of the doctrine of original sin, which basically says that we're all born sinners, and we would say, amen. And so thus, if baptism, and what was happening was when they saw the connection between salvation and baptism, that is, you see, everyone who gets saved gets baptized, and so it stood to reason, let's make this as early as possible, and so this is where infant baptism becomes more regular, and the understanding that it washes away original sin. It was during this time in the early centuries that the rise of the ordinances of baptism and communion took on a sort of sacramental belief. That is, that if I get baptized and if I take communion, I'm receiving grace, I'm receiving forgiveness, I'm receiving a special blessing from God. All this was taking place very early on. And so with that, I mean, even Constantine, who really was the one who paved the way for the church and the state to become one and all of that and kind of legalized Christianity, Constantine in the 300s, we're told, waited until his deathbed to be baptized, because he believed that the baptism would take his sin away and would take away all former sins, and so he waited until just before he died. Some people think he was already dead. But what difference does it make? It was a false belief. By 400, Augustine, who every element of Christendom looks to and praises the Lord for the great truth that he espoused, but even Augustine, by 400 AD, preached the universal practice of infant baptism for the forgiveness of original sin. By 413 AD, the Roman emperors, were putting out death warrants to anyone who would rebaptize or who would be the rebaptizer. So if you think about it, that kind of fear, the fear of being rebaptized, having trusted Jesus, or to actually be the one who baptizes somebody who trusts Jesus, the fear of dying for that, pretty much keep me in check for a while. And for hundreds, in fact, centuries to come, infant baptism became the standard for initiation into God's family and into the church. Many notable Reformed and Lutheran theologians to this day acknowledge that you can't find infant baptism in the Bible. B.B. Warfield, the noted esteemed Presbyterian theologian who baptized children, said, I can't find it. He said, you have to insert it into the Bible if you're going to believe it. Well, that should tell us something, shouldn't it? The Reformers had a principle called the regulative principle that basically said, if it's not in the Bible, you have to throw it out, which we would say, amen. But they contradicted themselves in this regard when it came to infant baptism. Consequently, they had to come up with a theology and find it somehow in the Bible. That's exactly what they did. And by the way, one of their biggest arguments is history. They say, well, history's on our side. We find instances of infants being baptized in the 200s. And that's why I love what John MacArthur so powerfully states. He says, history is not our hermeneutic. History is not a principle of interpretation. It doesn't matter what happened in history. I'm saying it like I think MacArthur did. A lot of things happen in history that can't be reviewed as a revelation of God. Only honest hermeneutics, honest exegesis in the Scripture can yield the true meaning of Scripture. You can't read habits into the Scripture. You can't read traditions into Scripture, unquote. Amen. Now, in fairness to our Reformed friends who otherwise preach the gospel, Luther, Zwingli, and many others, perhaps forced because of these radicals like Balthasar Hubmaier and others, they formed a theology, and they based it off of the Old Testament circumcision. You know, you got babies that would be circumcised and thus initiated into the covenant family of God. And they said, well, you see, that's the parallel. The parallel is baptism. Even though the New Testament doesn't give us that precedent, it doesn't make it analogous. They look at the household baptisms, especially in the book of Acts. And in 1 Corinthians, Paul baptized the household of Stephanus. The Philippian jailer's household got baptized. And so they argue from silence there must have been children there or babies there. I'm always reminded of this Presbyterian family that we evangelized many years ago. They came to Christ. Their pastor was preaching to them that, you know, there had to be babies because these households got baptized. And I took him outside. I took a chance. There were 8 homes in his neighborhood. I said, do you know everybody in these homes? He said, yep, I know them all. I said, how many babies are in there? Nah, I was taking a risk here, you know. He goes, none, there's no babies. I said, okay, let me get this right. You got 8 homes in your neighborhood. Not one of them has a baby, but you're going to tell me all of these did. See, this is just what we call a flat-out argument from silence. It doesn't fly, and nor should it fly. It doesn't have any biblical support. So they would cite circumcision, the household baptism, and they would say things like this, and they'll say this to this day. They'll say, well, you know, God is sovereign, and he saves people. He sovereignly saves people. And we would say, amen. They would say, well, you see, in the same way that God could saves an adult individual, he saves the baby when we baptize them. Now, let me ask you a question. Could God save an infant when they get baptized? Could he? I said, could he? Yes, he could. It's just not taught here. It's not taught. It's an argument from silence, plain and simple. And so what happened is, so while the Bible is our sole source of authority, we do have a group in history to be greatly thankful for courageously championing the biblical principle of believers' baptism and often paying the ultimate price from virtually every other sect of Christendom and not just Roman Catholics. The Anabaptists, the radicals as they were called, which Balthazar Hubmaier was a leader, and he would pay the ultimate price for his faith in Christ and his desire for the public declaration of faith. And that is what this is. And that's I want to lead this into our text here this morning before we baptize a few individuals. Let's look at it again. All authority in heaven and earth is given to me. Go and make disciples. That's the command. That's the imperative in this text. Make disciples. In so doing, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And teach them to observe everything I've commanded. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. I want to share with you this morning that believers' baptism then follows the authority and command of Jesus to make disciples. That's what we're all about. We baptize believers because believers' baptism, and we'll put that up there for in a moment. We baptize believers because believers' baptism, number one, identifies us publicly with Jesus in his death, burial, and resurrection. That's what it does. Baptism in Bible times always pictured cleansing, but not always death. Christian baptism pictures both the death and the resurrection of Jesus. It pictures death and life. Romans chapter 6 says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. May it never be. Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Don't you know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death. That just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. Having been united together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Life, resurrection. So the powerful picture is right there for us. We baptize believers because believers' baptism identifies us publicly with Jesus in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And it doesn't matter what kind of cost you're going to incur. Today, you know, we don't get stretched out on the rack or dunked to our death. They would say, you want to be baptized? We'll baptize you. They drowned him. And we're not facing that. Or being burned at the stake. But we might face other things. Imagine Adoniram Judson and Luther Rice. Those are words, names that should be familiar. Both men have colleges named after him today. 1812, both traveling to Calcutta, India, as missionaries with the support of their congregational churches back home, which believed that you should baptize babies. On the two separate ships, both of them studied the subject of baptism separate of one another. And the word baptizo, which means to plunge, immerse, both concluded infant baptism should be rejected. Both believed they should be publicly expressing their faith in Jesus. Both, under the auspices of William Carey, were baptized publicly when they got to India. And both lost their support back home. Now, I don't know what it's going to cost you to identify with Jesus in his death, burial, and resurrection, but what does it matter? Is he worth it? Just the other day, I'm talking to a young man. Unbeknownst to me, he comes to faith in Christ coming here to Sailorville Church. He just told me this yesterday. And I said, what did you say to your mom? Well, I told my mom. What'd she do? He goes, well, she got tears. I thought to myself, wait till you tell her you're getting baptized. We baptize people because it identifies us publicly with the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. We baptize believers because it recognizes the work of all three persons of the Godhead in our salvation. Notice what Jesus said, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The name, the word name is singular. He didn't say baptize them in the names. He could have, but he didn't, because Jesus was recognizing the oneness, the unity of God. God is one, but he exists in three persons, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. That's the Trinity as we understand it. And this passage of Scripture amplifies the Godhead and all of their individual contribution, if you please, to our salvation. I like to say that the Father selects, the Son saves, and the Spirit seals. And if you think about it, this shows you the overall comprehensive element of salvation. The Father selects. When did the Father select us? In eternity past. Chosen in him before the what? The foundation of the world. So from the Father's perspective, we were saved in his heart when he selected us, when he chose us. The Son saves. When did he save us? Well, we know when he saved us in 33 AD when he died on the cross and rose again from the dead. In time, the Son saved. Glory. But when were you saved? Individually. When did it become what theologians would call efficacious, real, effectual? Well, the Spirit seals. Ephesians 1. Ephesians chapter 4 tells us that upon our faith in Jesus, the Spirit of God becomes the very seal upon our heart. And for me, it was September 6th, 1982, when I placed my faith in Jesus Christ. The fact that the Father selected, the Son saved, and the Spirit came in and made it real. When he changed my heart. And so we baptize people because it recognizes the full-on glory to God, our triune God's work in our lives to save us. I love what Jonathan Rainbow says. Baptism is the expression and embodiment of the saving work of God. I love that. It's the expression and the embodiment of the saving work of God. And finally, we baptize believers because believers' baptism continues and fuels the process of sanctification. Believers' baptism continues and fuels the process of sanctification. So Jesus says, make disciples in the process of so doing, baptize them in the name of the triune God and teach them to observe all that I've commanded you. And I'll be with you from here on in. The teaching is that sanctifying edification ministry. Notice I say it continues. I didn't say it starts the process. The process is started on the day you give your heart to Jesus. You truly trust him as your personal Lord and Savior. That's when the process begins. I like what Andrew Fuller said in 1812. Baptism promotes piety in the individual and purity in the church. The reason for this is because when you get baptized after you're saved, you've got a momentum going. The process is like a juggernaut. It's just moving on. And so you see Jesus give this order, then you look in the book of Acts, that's what they do. They get saved, they get baptized. That's the reason why a lot of these churches over the years began to just attach the two and thinking the baptism had something to do with your salvation because they got baptized so quickly. But the idea was to keep the ball rolling, so to speak, in your walk with God, and your public expression of your faith sort of gives way to your willingness to be obedient in other areas of the Christian life. And by the way, whatever point of the Christian life you are unwilling to obey, it is at that very point where you stop growing. Let me say that to you again. Whatever point in the Christian life that you are not willing to obey, it's at that point that the worship and the growth stops. If you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ and you have not been baptized, you are an anomaly. That doesn't make any sense. Biblically speaking, baptism is the public declaration of the full-on disciple of Jesus Christ. That's what it is. And some of you here today have never been saved. That's what it means to make a disciple. Jesus said, make disciples. He didn't just say, get people to pray prayers. That means from your heart, you say, I follow you. You're my Lord and my Savior. I follow you. Go and make disciples. Are you a disciple of Jesus? Have you given your heart to him, believing in his death, his burial, and his resurrection for you? Have you made that heart decision for him? Some of you need to today, and I'm urging you to do so. Some of you need to be baptized. As I said, the New Testament knows of no unbaptized people. They get saved, they get baptized. If you're an Orthodox Jewish home, they'll turn their nose up to you if you claim Jesus as your Savior. They will treat you as dead if you get baptized, because you have taken what you believe inwardly and you have made it real outwardly. Some of you need to see what you're about to see again, public baptisms, as reminders. In the same way, when you go to a wedding and you hear the man and the woman make vows to one another until death do us part, and you remember when you go to those weddings, or at least you should, this is what I vowed when I got married. This is what I said to my husband. This is what I said to my wife. And through hell or high water, we're going in. We're going to go for this thing. We're going to live through this thing. We'll get through this. In the same way, when you see somebody publicly express their faith in Jesus Christ, those of you who have been saved, those of you who have been baptized, you look at this thing and you remind yourself of your vow to live for Jesus Christ. That's why you've seen people in baptism or heard of it, some of you, where people will get baptized and they'll renounce Satan and they'll live for Jesus. We don't do that here, but I kind of like it. And it's your idea to say, it's your opportunity to say, God, I have trusted Jesus as my Savior. I have died with him. I have been buried with him. I have been resurrected with him. And I want to live for him. And thank you for reminding me of that. So the question this morning is, where do you fit in there? Are you saved? Have you been baptized? Does this need to be a powerful reminder to you? Let's pray.